Over the last few years, several papers have shown that the neighborhood you grew up in has a causal impact on your future. Greater childhood exposure to better neighborhoods leads to increased college attendance and higher adult earnings, among other improved long-term outcomes. This raises the possibility that a policy lever for reducing inequality is to incentivize families to, quote, move to opportunity, end quote, or to relocate to better neighborhoods. But to what extent is this a scalable proposition? Would a large-scale migration of households from low to high opportunity neighborhoods actually be effective at reducing inequality? In this paper, the author addresses this question by studying perhaps the largest natural experiment in moving to opportunity in the US, the Great Migration. Between 1940 and 1970, 4 million African Americans left the South and moved to urban areas in the north and west of the country. A combination of political, social, and economic factors motivated this migration, and one component was the perception of greater opportunity for upward mobility in the North. This figure shows Black upward mobility at the commuting zone level in 1940, and illustrates that upward mobility for Black children was much higher outside of the South. What impact did this large in-migration have on destination cities in the North? The author points out that the current geographic distribution of Black upward mobility in the US looks very different from that of 1940. In particular, many locations that exhibited good outcomes for Black children in 1940 now exhibit some of the worst outcomes, and there is no longer a clear advantage for Black children growing up outside of the South. This raises the question, while greater upward mobility in the North motivated many families to relocate there during the mid-1900s, did this large-scale migration eventually erode the same positive features that had initially drawn them? Establishing a causal link between migration flows during the 20th century and upward mobility today is complicated by the fact that cities that attracted migrants may be fundamentally different from those that didn't. Thus, any divergent patterns in upward mobility across these areas today may derive from these underlying differences, rather than being driven by differential exposure to the Great Migration. To overcome this obstacle, the author employs what is known as a shift-share strategy. In particular, she exploits the fact that, conditional on deciding to leave the South, Black migrants tended to move where previous migrants from their communities had settled. For example, Detroit and Baltimore were both major destinations during the Great Migration, yet migrants to these areas came from different parts of the South that experienced very different patterns of out-migration between 1940 and 1970. The plurality of migrants to Detroit originated from Alabama, where negative shocks to cotton production spurred out-migration. On the other hand, migrants to Baltimore primarily originated in Virginia, which was a major recipient of war production spending during World War II, and where war production jobs lowered out-migration rates. Thus, the author can predict the amount and timing of in-migration a given destination city would receive, purely by studying shocks to out-migration in its corresponding origin community. This figure shows that this measure of predicted in-migration is strongly correlated with actual migration observed over the 1940 to 1970 period, while, by construction, being arguably independent of any unique features of the destination areas themselves. Using this strategy, the author shows that there is a strong negative relationship between exposure to great migration inflows and measures of upward mobility today. In other words, mid-century shocks to the racial composition of northern cities lowered the average outcomes of children growing up in the same area decades later. The results suggest that a 30 percentile increase in a commuting zone's Black population during the Great Migration lowered the adult income of children from low-income families in the 1990s and 2000s by approximately 9%. The largest negative effects manifest for Black men. Now, there are two potential mechanisms that could be at work. The first, called the selection effect, is that the large influx of migrants changed the composition of households living in these areas in ways that led to lower income mobility on average. For simplicity, suppose that all households can be divided into two types, either high or low mobility. If migrants are more likely to be low mobility types, increasing the fraction of migrants in a given community will decrease average income mobility in the long term. The second potential mechanism, called the location effect, is that in response to these migration inflows, the cities themselves changed in ways that had a detrimental effect on their ability to facilitate Black upward mobility. In this scenario, even if migrant families were of the same mobility type as incumbent households, average income mobility may decline in the long term due to changes in the environment. The author decomposes her results between these two channels and finds that the location effect accounts for all of the negative impact of the Great Migration on average upward mobility. In particular, she provides evidence that greater in-migration of Southern Blacks led to decreases in white public school enrollment and increases in urban segregation, higher local government expenditures on policing, higher murder rates, and increased incarceration. Overall, she estimates that the changes in environment induced by the Great Migration account for 43% of the upward mobility gap between Black and white men in this region today. In conclusion, this paper provides evidence that racial composition changes resulting from the Great Migration led northern cities to change in ways that had a negative and persistent impact on Black upward mobility. These results have important implications for policies that incentivize families to move to areas with better opportunities. While these relocations may improve outcomes for individual households, this paper suggests that implementing these programs on a large scale may be more complicated. Further understanding the ways in which neighborhoods and cities respond to migration inflows is crucial for determining whether these policies constitute a scalable solution for reducing inequality. If you would like to delve deeper into this topic, you can check out the full paper, as well as its references to other related research. These include many papers studying neighborhood effects and the importance of childhood location on adult outcomes, prior work examining the effects of the Great Migration on destination cities, and finally, a theoretical literature on public goods provision when there are diverse and heterogeneous constituencies.